Thanks, Peter. I feel pretty terrible having to speak in English for all you guys, but I've learned some Flemish this afternoon. I now know how to say work breakdown structure and Jira Cloud instance in Flemish. So it's
Okay, cool.
so we learn something every day. All right, let me share my screen. Awesome. All right, hopefully that's you guys can see that all okay.
Yeah, it's great. Thanks.
Great. Okay, good stuff. Well, thanks very much to Peter and Walter for having us along today. It's always a pleasure to speak to our European colleagues. I've been working with Walter quite a lot with the early access program to some of the products we've been working on. We're really excited to show you some of the things that we've been working on in cloud today. So let's crack on. So today the talk is about maintaining calm in Jira Cloud. So you've learned today about, how are you going to migrate to cloud, what some of the experiences in cloud, and we're here to kind of assure you that there are existing apps and work being done all the time in Jira Cloud. So who are we? So I'm Paul Saunders. I'm based out of the UK. I'm a product manager for some of our next generation integration tools. And one of the most recent products that we just launched is last month was Project Configurator for Jira Cloud. And then I've got joining me Mo, who's also based out of the UK. He's one of our senior product managers, and he's working on Script Runner for Jira as well, and paying particular attention to Script Runner for Jira Cloud. So let's just have a look at what we're going to be talking about today. So agenda that we're just going to talk you through is just give you a quick introduction about some of our observations about Jira Cloud, looking in detail about what some of the expectations are against reality. We're going to have a little bit of a deep dive and a guided tour into some of the things about Script Runner for Jira Cloud, give you a quick guided tour, as I said. And then we're going to give you a preview of Project Configurator for Jira Cloud, which is our brand new product that we've just launched. Then we got some time for some questions as well. So let's see what we think. So we've spent quite a lot of time working on migrations. We've done some quite big migrations. We've also spent some time actually building apps in the ecosystem on cloud. So you may be familiar with on-premise apps such as Script Runner for Jira for Confluence. Also, you may have used Project Configurator for Jira Server or DC as well. We've got quite a lot of experience now of actually developing those apps in the cloud as well, and seeing some of those differences in some of the use cases. So one thing that we find a little bit frustrating is that from the Atlassian point of view, is there's a little bit of a binary approach where they sort of think that, okay, you're on server today, and you're going to be moving over to cloud or to data center. And as Walter explained, there's a lot of kind of prep work that you need to do, and a lot of challenges along the way. One thing that we see quite commonly is that certainly for larger enterprises, we see a lot of potentially lots of smaller instances where there's a consolidation exercise. So it's very rarely for larger organizations a circumstance where we're moving from just one instance to another new instance. There's tends to be a lot of consolidation work, and that might be a result of things like mergers and acquisitions and all kinds of things like that. So we see that as a reality. And in fact, when you're actually migrating, it's quite interesting seeing Walter talking about, oh, you can spin up lots of instances to do your testing. And we see that as a very regular thing, in that, if you're moving over to cloud or you're moving over to data center, you may have lots of like testing and staging and development environments that you want to exploit and want to take care of. And so that concept of a happy path is to put it bluntly, in certain circumstances, the larger and more complex the organization, a little bit of a fantasy. And so we've done a lot of work to help organizations, take that migration path in the way that suits them. What we found is there are no two organizations alike, and that it's very common for you to do a migration over many months rather than just over a weekend, for example. The other thing that we found in the future is we see cloud and on-premise instances of Jira and Confluence and Bitbucket sitting alongside each other. So there's very, very commonly where an organization will say, yep, I definitely want to move to cloud. We're very pro-cloud, we're cloud-friendly. But there will always be little tiny individual use cases that don't necessarily suit that. And so what we're seeing is a little bit of a fragmentation in future where individual projects that are, you know, maybe sensitive, they're governmental or they've got military context or something like that, where they do have to actually keep an on-premise instance. And so that concept of you having what we call a hybrid cloud approach, where you have some things on cloud, some things on data center, we see that as being very much fundamental to the future. And we're building tools and we're building technologies to allow that to happen. So we're going to show some of that today with what we've actually been working on with ScriptRunner Cloud and Project Configurator Cloud. So without further ado, let me hand over to Mo, who's going to tell you a little bit about the properties of ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Paul. So ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud is about 4.5 years old now. So it was a long time ago that actually Adaptivist said, we need to build this product in cloud. And the fundamental kind of principle has been, we must try and replicate the exact same experience that you can have on-prem on cloud. Now, again, that's a little bit of a happy fantasy because Jira Cloud is fundamentally different to Jira Server and Jira Data Center. But still, on the front end, what we've tried to do is make sure that the value that customers gain from ScriptRunner is the same. So even if the implementation behind the scenes is different, the features look the same, they give you the same end result, but it just might be that they take a slightly different path in getting there. So automating, customizing, extending, that is at the core of ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud in the same way that it's at the core of ScriptRunner for Jira Server and Data Center. So yeah, whether it's, you know, your tasks or reports, whether you want to kind of strip out manual processes, if you need to edit workflows, or if you need to, you know, extend your access and connect to different data sources, that's all still there in ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud. So if we could go to the next slide, please. To give you a summary of kind of where ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud is kind of the same and where it's different to on-prem. So we've got this slide where, you know, we're working towards that journey of value parity and in some cases beyond. And at the moment, we're very close to matching on-prem. So we have, you know, a lot of the core features that you'd expect: post functions, scheduled jobs, listeners, enhanced search. We've also got some things that on-prem doesn't have, which is kind of the and beyond section. So a workflow screen where you can actually edit workflows within ScriptRunner itself. You don't have to go and jump into the Jira menus. We've also got an onboarding flow. So if any of you have tried ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud in the last 2 or 3 months, you'll notice there's a welcome screen. We try and point you to all of the features, and we're trying to make use of the speed of delivery that you can have on cloud to try and help people come along on the journey in a much more easy way. We've also got, in a kind of beta phase one implementation, scripted fields, and we've actively got a roadmap to bring that up to speed to where on-prem is. And we've also last month, actually, we've allowed scripts to run for 120 seconds on cloud, and if customers need, we can go up to 240 seconds. And, you know, this is about us being fully aware that large enterprises, large companies will be moving to cloud, and we want to be absolutely ready for them, and we want to make sure that they can have their on-prem experience as closely as possible on cloud. Stuff that we don't have, behaviors, which I know is a very, very big topic. We get this question every time we speak about ScriptRunner for Jira Cloud. It's not available yet, but the good news is that we're actually working hand in hand with Atlassian to get the right API access on cloud to make behaviors a reality there. The great thing is Atlassian actually recognized the importance of this for cloud migrations. So that's something you should definitely watch out for. And also more built-in scripts. We know how useful they are. We want to add more, so that'll be coming as well. So without further ado, I will hand back to Paul for a guided tour.
That's great. Thanks, Mo. Well, luckily I'm part of the beta program, so I can show you some of those properties. So in my, this is my personal Jira instance that I have, and this is the new onboarding home screen that Mo was talking about. One thing, if you actually sign up for Script Runner for Jira Cloud right now, it actually takes you through an onboarding experience, and it actually tailors this this particular screen to your own personal experience. So if you've come from Script Runner for Jira Server, you know, you'd be familiar with a lot of the concepts, and it can tailor that experience a little bit for you. So yeah, we've invested quite a lot into user experience over the past couple of years. But pretty much everything else kind of looks and feels more or less the same. So, you know, if you're used to seeing, you know, your browse screen, and you love that in your Script Runner on-premise experience, then you've got that same kind of context and the same ability to actually search through your functionality in exactly the same way. And we have we've done a lot of work in terms of ensuring that we're aligned with the user experience as far as it is possible with the cloud environment. So we have, you know, your script console. We have the ability for you to have your script listeners. So you can see there's a slightly different UI there, and as Mo said, we're afforded the opportunity with cloud to experiment and roll and test improvements in the cloud environment ahead of them going into the server environment. So again, yeah, we can go through and see, you know, our individual tasks, scheduled jobs, escalation services. One of the new screens that Mo talked about that we have is workflows. If you're familiar with post functions in the old world of Jira Cloud, and also in Script Runner for Jira on premise as well, is you actually have to go into the Jira UI and go in through workflows and post functions to be able to put together a post function. Well, actually, we now have that ability to interact with those directly from our own Script Runner UI as well. So here we've got a grid of my existing workflows that I have in place, and here I can go and edit, and I can go and actually make changes to my script directly in there as well. One of the other changes that we have here as well is because of the actual UI restraints that we have within Jira Cloud, my enhanced search capability is actually via a separate screen. So what we have the ability here in Jira Cloud, when you go into apps, which is one of the menus here, if you're an administrator, then you can obviously go in and go and use Script Runner for Jira, but then we expose the enhanced search capability directly from its own UI, and so that everybody can go and go and make use of that particular functionality as well. So that's pretty much it for Script Runner as a quick guided tour for the time that we've got. So project configurator for Jira Cloud. So as I mentioned, we have had for a number of years project configurator for Jira Server and DC available and very popular app and very core to our business and actually to our migration practice that we have. So we use Project Configurator for Jira Server and Jira Data Center as a means of moving configuration and issues between instances. So it's very popular as a moving your configuration between a staging and a production instance in a server environment. So we were limited. We never had the cloud version of this app available because of the limitations with the APIs. And in the same way that Mo was talking about with behaviors, we've been working directly with the Atlassian team to open up those APIs and define the actual configuration that we actually want to be able to move between instances. So last month, we were really proud to release Project Configurator for Jira Cloud. And what that allows us to do is actually move configuration between instances. And we're seeing this as a growing demand. As larger organizations are moving into cloud, they're looking to take advantage of having, you know, staging and production environments where they want to be able to test some project configuration. You know, then maybe they want to add a new workflow, or maybe they want to add a new issue type, or something like that. They want to be able to put that through a central templated or staging environment, but then automatically move that across. So before the release of Project Configurator, the only way that they could do that is manually configuring that that configuration itself, you know, copying it by hand. So one big saving that we've got there is it's reducing those errors. So if we're actually moving it through the API through this product, then, you know, you're eliminating all of those human errors. It's obviously a time consuming task to actually manually do those. And we've seen a lot of our bigger enterprise customers who have dozens of instances, they just simply something that they haven't done in the past. They maybe have a templated instance and they won't bother to update the config to all of their instances. And the other big benefit we get from that is, you know, you've got that audit trail and full traceability of any configuration changes that have been made. And as I said, we're working with Atlassian and we're looking to extend that capability out even further. So quickly, I can show you a quick demo of that. So Project Configurator for Jira Cloud, unlike some of our other apps, or most of our other apps, it's not actually an app that you install within your Jira instance like you would do with Script Runner or any other Connect plugin that you download from the marketplace. This app is actually it's standalone. It's a complete web app. And the reason why we've done it this way is we want to be able to allow you to connect multiple instances together. So if you have lots of test instances, then you can still utilize this and you're still paying the same fee. And in fact, right now it's actually free for the next couple of months, just as we've launched as a, you know, as a means to allow people to try it. So if you were to go to pc.adaptivist.com, you'll see our website, which talks about all of the use cases. And in fact, we had a nice quote from Walter, who was involved in our early access program, to actually test this product. So let me take you through the user journey here. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to sign in, and my sign-in path, what I'm prompted here is I'm prompted to sign in with my Google ID, or I could connect via any other means that I want, with just a username and password. And then in here, what I've got when it's signed in is this is my menu, is a web application here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to kick off my simulation that I've got set up here. So I've set up, let me just talk you through this first. I've got this project here called ACA in my staging instance, and I want to move it into my production instance. So I've got this production instance which doesn't have any projects set up in there. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go and kick off my simulation. Now, what that does is it is all cloud based. So this is just preparing my simulation that I want to do. And hopefully within a few seconds, that'll actually kick that off and it'll actually start analyzing all of the data. So there we can see it's actually running the simulation and it's exporting those. Now, the simulation is actually quite an important step. That isn't forced on you if you're an on-premise customer of Project Configurator. But one decision that we made was we want to ensure that you're not going to break your production instance. So one thing that we've done is we actually force that simulation to be carried out. And basically what happens is it analyzes all of the data that I've got, checks that everything is good, and then basically then gives me a report to say, yeah, this is safe for you to actually carry out that migration. So that's going to carry on in real time. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to dip into another screen while that's working away and show you some of the other features. So the connections grid, what that allows me to do, it allows me to define lots of different instances that I can connect to. Let's come back to that one. And so allow, as I mentioned, it allows you to connect to multiple instances there. Now, the reporting screen, this is where we would actually look and see the results of all my previous history. So for example, in this particular one, I can actually go and drill down and look at some more information about this particular bit of feedback that I had. So here it's actually simulating the screen scheme. Some of the feedback that I would have might have quite a lot more information. And here I can see the date and time. So this is where we're getting a kind of a nice kind of feedback of what we're actually seeing here. So I can see that invocation's finished. So I'm going to go into my migration now. And what I could do is I could actually filter this and just look at any errors that I'm interested in. So are there any errors? No, there's no errors there, so that's good. I do have a warning though. Now what it's telling me here is that this workflow doesn't exist in the target instance. Now we have a limitation with the Jira API right now where workflows are not actually supported. Now what we have to do in this scenario is it will, if there's a workflow that exists that has the same name, then it will associate that with the project that I migrate across. But in this particular case, I don't have that same workflow. And so what it does is it's telling me it's going to use the default workflow instead. Now, this is new. This is something that we're working with Atlassian on, and they're rolling out additional capabilities all of the time. But if I go and look at my success, I can see it was so successful, it told me twice. So I'm happy to actually go ahead and do my migration now based on the feedback that I've got. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and migrate that right now. So that's all pretty good. So the other thing that we have from here is, so there it goes. It's going to go off and run all of that. Now, while that's going on, we've got the documented help associated with all of this. So here we can actually go in and see everything I need to know about how to carry out a migration. Here we also have documented all of the individual object types that are supported as well. So as I mentioned, you know, there are some limitations right now. So for example, Jira Classic and business projects are supported, but if I were to go down and look at the non-supported objects, I can actually see that next-gen projects and Jira software projects are not yet supported. So this is something that Atlassian are working on. And you can see there are a number of additional configuration entities that are not supported yet. But as I said, these are things that we're working actively on, and you know, we hope to roll out in the next few weeks. You can always keep an eye on our release notes as well. And in our release notes, you can see everything that's been added. So there's little notes here about some bug fixes and some little improvements that we added. So in the reports, we added the ability for you to actually filter on test and real migrations as well. So let's have a look at that. That's still ticking away. That's good. So that's reassuring. So just while we're doing that, let me just go and have a look at what else we have in here. So if I go into the help and support mode, here you can actually see access to all the various different documentation resources that we have. So we've got like the release notes, we've got like a get started page as well. We also have a feedback system as well. So, you know, we're encouraging people who are like early adopters to actually go in and actually provide some feedback to us on what you think about this product. And what you can actually do is you can actually vote on some of these issues that we've actually got raised as well. So support for custom fields is something that we're working on right now. I could look at this in a roadmap sense as well and see what's coming up. So yeah, support for custom fields has been voted on a few times, and we're actively working on that. So you could go and make a suggestion if you tell us what you think. So let's go and have a look how we're getting on. So it's almost done. Unfortunately, it's not a quick job to actually move data across, but what I can do is I could actually go and have a look at my instance now. Ah, there we go, just finished. Perfect timing. So this is my staging instance, and here I can actually go and have a look at some of the config that we had set up in here. So this is my source project, and the versions that I had set up, if I look at what was released and unreleased, so here you can see I've got a couple of versions in here. I've got a couple of components in here, just as some examples. If I go now to my production instance, and if I hit refresh, there is my project. So ACAIT, it's a classic business project. It's picked me up as being the lead. And if I drill into that, let's see what other information it's managed to pass across. If I go to project settings. So there we are. It's pulled everything across, including the URL that I used, including my description. It's pulled me across as the project lead and the default assignee. If I look at versions, let's have a look what it's brought across here. So here it's actually brought all of my version data across, including descriptions, release dates, and it's brought my components across as well. And then as well as all of that, it's brought across the issue types, issue layouts, and so on as well. So there we go. That is Project Configurator in a very short nutshell. And back to my slides, almost finished now. That is it. We'd be very happy to take any questions that you have. So thankfully the demo gods were shining on me today. That's nothing like a live demo to fly by the seat of your pants. Just having a look at the Q&A and any chat. Let's just see.
Yeah, two questions popped up, Paul, in the meantime. I believe they're from the same. It's Chris. And the first question was that, what does that mean with regards to personal data, GDPR, in the cloud configurator? Do you process any of the data yourselves?
Yeah, that's a great question. So actually, the answer to that is no, because what we're doing is we're doing a direct connection between the two instances, and we're not processing anything at all itself. So any kind of personal data that might be within individual content, that's we're just the processor. We're not actually handling any of that GDPR sensitive data yourself. What we do have is we do keep the logs. So if, for example, you saw in some of the cases, some of the feedback is in an XML format. If there is personal data in there, we see ourselves as being the processor, and you as the end user as being using that. And you have the ability to go in and delete those logs if they're sensitive to you. But yeah, I can provide copies of all of our privacy policy and GDPR, all of that kind of stuff to show how we treat that data for you. But the short answer is no, we don't handle it.
Okay, great, thanks. And the second question also from Chris is, can you also use it for update? And I'm presuming, as you showed, it was for an initial copy project
and
configuration
as well. Yeah, that's absolutely right. So one limitation that we have right now is if you want to copy a project across, it will you have to select the entire project, and as you saw, it takes a few minutes to do that. But yeah, if the project exists already in your production instance, what it'll do is it'll overwrite that configuration for you. We're working on a way for us to allow you to what we call cherry pick that configuration. So let's say, for example, you've just done a version update, for example, you know, and you don't want to have all of that other stuff being copied over and taking the time and, you know, risking those. One thing that we're looking to do is to allow you to cherry pick that configuration. So let's say, for example, I just want to update versions, and then that would be a much quicker exercise. The other thing that we're working on right now as well is doing app configuration as well. So let's say, for example, you've done a script runner script in your staging instance, you've tested all of that, you want that to actually go across. We're working hand in hand with the script runner team to be able to move that configuration as well. And we see config management as being an area that is not necessarily supported out of the box by Atlassian. And we see that as a role for ourselves to actually help you with that configuration management there. So you can expect to see quite a few updates along that lines in the next few months.
Great. And there's just one final short question, perhaps with the time remaining, is what are the main challenges basically when migrating script runner from server to cloud?
Oh, well, we could talk about that for hours over a beer one day. But
that question was actually coming from Walter. So,
well, I'll try and keep it short. So, yeah, the main challenges are that obviously the APIs between server and cloud are actually quite different. And the way that they actually handle the scripts are actually constructed are actually very difficult. And it's not easy for us to do. In fact, it's almost impossible for us to do a transcode of actually saying, you know, what does this script do and how do we need that to work in cloud? The other thing that we see as well as part of that exercise of moving over the cloud is people use that as an exercise to completely change their ways of working. There are entities that exist in server that don't necessarily exist in cloud, or you might have a very slightly different way of working. So the challenge that we have is sitting down with the customer, understanding what the source script is actually doing, and then help deciding what that business case is moving across. And Mo was talking a little bit about the value comparison between script runner cloud and script runner server, and we see that as the comparison there is we can do the same thing, we can solve the same business challenges, But the way it's done is slightly different between server and cloud. So it's getting the end users to kind of understand that notion and getting them to understand what is the context around their script and how do we need to implement that in the new world. So it's a slightly re-implementation. Go ahead.
I think the only other thing I'd say is to only migrate what you need to migrate. So spend the time up front planning and being ruthless about what you don't need, because there's no point spending time on that.
Absolutely right. Yeah. Hopefully that answers that question.